Kaizen Master, you know, he helped me with the game, but yo, bumped the game for a second. He helped me way more as a person. He taught me how to get my confidence back.
I ran to this Ryu player named Kaizen Master, and I didn't think nothing of it. He beat me. Okay. I get an invite to a party, and then he invited me to something that Street Fighter 4 had called the Replay Channel. And I'm like, hello? And he's like, what do you want tomorrow?
Yeah, so there was a guy named Kaizen Master. He helped me train. And talking to Kaizen Master, we, after each match, win or lose, we just go into the Replay Channel and break down.
He's the person I would say, like, I would the most talk about Street Fighter by far, yeah, because we would talk about everything.
I ended up suggesting to Tempo Storm that we bring on one of my old mentors and one of my old coaches. His ID is Kaizen Master. People might know him from Street Fighter.
Where Kaizen, we would go and watch YouTube videos together and stuff, like on the Art of War, and it could be a cooking video, man, like stuff that seemingly wouldn't have anything to do with fighting games, but it lines up perfectly.
When you read the Kaizen Master's book of Art of War.
Okay. What is chapter one?
Understanding the ways and postulating the possibilities.
We used to study psychology and sociology.
Yeah, Kaizen Master's interesting. He had suggested actually going into games and just purely using the game just for practicing defense. Like, yeah. not win or lose or anything like that.
Yeah. He gives me all kinds of different theories of how to approach.
When I try to learn how to pressure with light attacks, I only played with light attack.
Yeah.
But that was Kaizen that gave me that idea. He inspired that.
If it's a problem, you can't fix it. It's always a challenge instead.
So when you don't have challenge, life becomes meaningless, right?
Kaizen Master always dropping gems.
Kaizen's brightest gems are his students. We've heard from his students that have emerged at the top of their respective fields while maintaining tight bonds with one another. But now we hear from him. The principle of Kaizen guides his mentorship approach throughout all of his ventures. By the end of this interview, you'll know what Kaizen means and what it means to Jose, Kaizen Master Rodriguez, to be walking on Kaizen's path.
What's going on, everybody? It's your boy Haney, aka Scion of Beyond Framed It. And today, I'm joined with, and I don't even know how to put it, one of the legends of the FGC. Ladies and gentlemen, Kaizen Master. What's going on, Kaizen? How you doing?
Nice to meet you. Thank you for having me in.
Of course, absolutely. there's so many questions I want to start with you. I don't even know where to really begin, but let's take it all the way back from the FGC, right? Let's take it all the way back to what got you into the FGC in the first place, like why, and why Street Fighter?
Yeah, that's a good question. it was like the, you know, 80s, I was an 80s kid, and, you know, I dabbled in video games here and there, the Game Boy and, you know, whatever simple video games came out, you know, those like dollar ones you buy.
Any
little video game. I wasn't buying them, so it was my mother, so whatever just came through my, you know, path, I played with it. But I didn't know I was a gamer, or I didn't have, you know, this like need to play games. It was just whatever was there. I was, you know, just a regular 80s kid who played outside, like most 80s kids did. We played outside with sticks and rocks.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
But so my best friend at the time, he had a mother who worked downtown near Chinatown. She worked over there at a bank, and so we would go with her to work. And then he, you know, for the first time around 1990, yeah, I think it was 1990, the fall of 1990, introduced me to the arcade for the first time. So we walked over from her work to the arcade. It was called Teddy Bear Arcade. So you remember Teddy Bears?
Barely.
Yeah.
Barely.
So there was Chinatown Arcade and Teddy Bear Arcade. Okay. And Teddy Bear Arcade was in the theater district. I went over there with him, and I guess he liked to play Excitebike in Mario 1. So we were on that side of the arcade. They had like different sections. And, you know, it was just a lot of noise everywhere. But one day when I went by myself and he wasn't there, I decided to explore, you know, the arcade more, because every time we just make a beeline to those games that he liked. He also played those fantasy like games with elves. What is that called? The Golden Axe and stuff.
Oh, yeah. Gauntlet Legends.
Yeah, he played all those kind of games, like even the shooter games with, you know, the airplane shooting. He played those kind of games, never fighting games. Okay. So the whole time though, I kept hearing all this noise.
Yeah.
and like, you know, just very loud noise, and I didn't know where that was coming from. So when he wasn't there one day, I was playing Mario, heard all the noise, and I decided to go see what it was. It happened to be Street Fighter 1 with the pads that you have to punch.
Dang.
You remember?
Yeah,
remember
no, that? I know that.
Yeah,
that's,
so
it's a lot. Old.
Yeah, that's how that started. So this is like December 91, I think, is when I finally decided to move over to fighting games because of the, you know, just the dynamic nature of that little niche community there in arcade.
Yeah.
So I moved over to Street Fighter 1. Soon they switched over to the buttons instead of the pads. And yeah, I mean, I guess I could just say that's how I started is one day just on my own, I decided to see what all the noise was about, I guess.
That's sick. That's dope. So out of all the fight, I mean, at this point, like, you know, a lot of fighting games then came out after that. Like, we got Street Fighter 2, you know, Marvel vs. Capcom series. We got the King of Fighters series. We got, like, Soul Calibur, even Mortal Kombat. Mm-hmm. There's so many other fighting games that came out. What stuck you to Street Fighter? What stood out for you, basically?
Well, I'm highly, highly competitive. The thing is, when people say they're competitive, it tends to be toxic competitiveness, you know, where, you know, they step on people to get what they, you know, want.
Yeah.
I'm not the kind that I am. I'm not that kind of person. My competitiveness comes from me trying to improve myself. So if I start something, then I want to get better, and then eventually it becomes an obsession. So because I started on Street Fighter, and that was something that I liked over the games my friend played, I just kept going down that path, and I never would stop because I'm never gonna reach mastery. I'm never gonna become, you know, perfect. So I'm just gonna always go down that rabbit hole of fighting games. That's how I continued.
Okay, and that's what led you to Street Fighter itself. Like that series stuck out to you. You're like, you know what? I'm gonna look at Street Fighter.
It was more so that all the other games like the basketball game, you know, get tickets and stuff, and racing car games. There was no, as the FGC calls, hype. There was no hype around it. There was no competitive nature. There was no one-upping and all this stuff.
There was no competitive.
Yeah, it was just no scene. It was just random people coming off the street, getting some tickets and getting some toy, you know?
Now,
so that's why that was the only one that had competitive nature and competitive, so.
Perfect. So you know, if you talk to anybody within the New England FGC, or if you talk to anybody in the FGC, even spanning outside of New England, you know, you'll hear little things here and there saying how, you know, you, at some point or another, they've come in contact with you, and they themselves have become something they feel is, they've progressed deeply in their FGC career, if you will. So besides just a player, you've also become, you know, a mentor, a life coach, a fighting game coach to them, and everything. Where did that get started? Like, what made you get a passion to be a mentor?
I don't like having abilities and resources and understanding, and then keeping it to myself. I just can't stand by and see somebody who has aspirations and is confused about how to, you know, achieve those things, and then I have it, but I don't give it. I can't do that. I just don't feel right about hoarding stuff like that. I have to help somebody if I can, basically. For example, years after I started fighting games, in the mid 2000s, when I was, you know, a practicing Christian, my discipler called one time just out of the blue. I was playing StarCraft 1, and he called out of the blue and said, "Hey, you have a, you know, big apartment, and this homeless guy just came up, you know, afraid of the winter time, because, you know, he doesn't have anywhere to live. Can you house him temporarily until we get to know him, and then we can share the burden and help him get through the winter time?" I said yes, just like that, not knowing anything else.
Oh,
about
wow.
him. I just said yes.
Wow.
And then he said,
"That's crazy."
And then he said, "Well, see, if I'm gonna be a practicing Christian at the time,
you gotta do.
Then, like, how can I say no?"
Right.
See what I'm saying? You know, if you're gonna follow the you know, the rules, you know.
You gotta follow it to the line.
Yeah, if you're gonna follow, you know, what you're learning in the Bible or in Christianity, you just have to do that by default. Now, after, as soon as I said yes, he said, well, there's something I have to tell you. He just got out of prison for murder, and he was in there for 11 years. And I said, yes. I took like 5 seconds to think about it because my family is kind of close by. Mm-hmm. But I realized that I can't let that change my mind. Because if I'm a so-called Christian, then I'm going to have so-called faith to believe that doing this good deed will work out well. See what I'm saying? Like, if you're going to believe what you're, you know, learning in that, you know, faith, then you got to follow through all the way.
Yeah.
So, to renege just because of some social stigma against people like that, you know, it's hypocritical. So I said yes. And he stayed with me for 2 months. And then they shared the burden like we planned. And eventually we changed his life. And then one day, you know, months or years, I don't remember how long later, maybe like a year or two later, he drove by my house with his cell phone, and he was in somebody else's car. I guess he had an apartment and everything. You know, that's just what I do. If I can help, I'm going to help. That's it.
Now, you know, your mentorship has spanned across so many different things and so many different games and even outside games and whatnot. Where do you feel what's your specialty? What do you feel like you're, especially in Street Fighter, when I want to stick to like FGC and Street Fighter, where's your specialty lie? Like, well, is it picking up people's habits? Is it like, where do you feel like you strive the most as a mentor?
Are you saying as a mentor or as a teacher? Because
both.
Those are two different things, and I do both.
Okay, as a teacher first, and then as a mentor.
As a teacher, the primary thing that I do, which you can also hear from a lot of my students who give, you know, testimony, Rob TV, for example, in his documentary, he said it, mentality. Mentality is what I help people to work on, help them work on their mentality. Even in your own Nelbaum documentary, interview, he said that I help them change as a human being, help them improve as a human being beyond whatever I did for him in Street Fighter. And so, you know, I helped him gain his confidence back. That's what he said. Other people say, you know, like I helped them realize that they were in the wrong college major and they changed their major. But they realize these things about their personal life through what I teach them about being a strong player in Street Fighter. So that's the teacher side. And my teacher side of Street Fighter influences them personally. So then that's how the mentor comes second.
Okay.
The mentorship. I don't seek out a Street Fighter student to be their mentor, but if someone works with me in a win-win capacity, then it ends up being that way.
Yeah. All right, so mentality is like the top.
That's thing. My primary thing, but I will say that maybe not now because of Street Fighter V and we have all these new apps and technology, but before Street Fighter V, the community as a whole, globally, across the board, in pretty much all fighting games, frowned on frame data. They frowned on hitboxes. Damn. They frowned on all like any assistance aside from being, you know, like an OG who has instincts, you know.
Talking.
So, what I the way I stood out back then was teaching frame data, hitbox, all the stuff that they frowned on. That's actually. And specifically for Street Fighter, what attracted me to the game, I was not going to play this game, or Street Fighter, Street Fighter 5 is out now, but Street Fighter 4, I was not going to play. I was a real estate agent at the time, in 2010, my, you know, had some appointments at 1:30 p.m., then I had some more at 5 p.m., so it was around 12:30 p.m., I decided to, you know, at Downtown Crossing, get some lunch before my appointments, and charge my phone in GameStop because they would let me eat and they would let me loiter.
You talk about the downtown GameStop? Yeah, they would let me eat. You're throwing me back. Well, man, you're taking me back.
They would let me eat and then let me loiter and charge my phone, so I went there.
That was like the hub, actually.
Yeah, it was. And so that's where all this got started in for Street Fighter 4 in my case. Damn. Coming back offline into fighting games. That was actually a PC
game. They used to have like a Super Smash Bros. Brawl set up. In like the middle of that whole
area. Yeah, in the
like,
middle, yeah.
Yeah,
I dabbled in
love that.
Whatever they had there. But, you know, I seen Street Fighter Vanilla and the
Street Fighter 4.
Street Fighter 4 Vanilla. The graphics, if you remember, it were kind of like the 3D animation that, you know, 2.5D animation was kind of wonky and made the characters look funny. People complained about Blanca's face and stuff. So, you know, when I saw it, I didn't really like it. I didn't play fighting games for the last time I played fighting games before 2010 was DOA and Tekken 3 in college, early 2000s.
Wow.
So I didn't play for like 8 years more, 8 to 10 years. Mm. So then this is the first time I'm coming back to consoles and I'm like, oh, let me see how the graphics are these days, you know, a decade later. So I go in and I see that. I'm like, So then, so 6 months passed and then that's when I needed to charge my phone and eat and stuff. Then I saw it again and this time it was Super Street Fighter 4. They had Viper and Jury. And just hearing Viper, you know, her yelling, all her aggressive pounding.
Ground pound?
Yep. And then the Jury animation with her kissing you on her ultra and everything and the close up, you know.
You're like, I'm in.
Yeah, that
I'm in.
That went far away from Ryu and Ken, you know, the standard stuff I've been doing since, you know, Street Fighter 1. So that made me more interested.
Yeah.
And I guess that made me interested to go back there, but I still was trying to keep myself away from games because, like I said, I'm competitive, and like if I start something, I'm going to follow through. And I did not want to do that. I wanted to follow through on real estate. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't be distracted. But there was this one guy there who he was very interesting because I saw him just going around to everyone with a big smile on. I never saw anyone who smiled so much in my life.
Who's this?
He was a casual player. I think his name was John or something like that. He would just go around. He was a college student at UMass Boston. He worked at Dunkin' Donuts.
Yeah.
And he would just go around everyone talking about day trading, penny stocks and day trading. He would just talk about all the stuff no one cared about, and everyone would just pretend, you know, with a fake smile to listen and care because they wanted free coffee. I even heard a few people asking for free coffee at Dunkin' Donuts. You know? So, and every time he got rejected, I saw him with a big smile goes to the next person. And that is sales. That's high-level sales. And I was the sales manager.
High-level sales.
And I was the sales manager for my real estate broker at the time. So I was thinking, oh, this guy, if I can get him into real estate and have him work with us, this guy's going to be awesome, you know, because of those basic qualities.
Yeah.
So I was like, wow, man. So I started focusing on him instead of the game. Until I, you know, finally met him, and then while I was starting to talk to him and get to know him, he's like, hey, why don't we play games as we talk? And that's how I started playing. So it was because of him, you know, trying to get him into real estate, which is why I ended up playing the game. And then over time, I met people like Nito. Do you know Nito?
Yeah, I know Nito. That's one of my besties.
So Nito, I relate to Nito.
That's my boy, man.
Yeah, I relate to him. And actually,
shout outs to Nito. Yes, I got to get Nito on this.
Yes, 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 please. I saw him and in the back of my mind he looked familiar.
Like David Cross.
I kept looking at him. Mm-hmm. I kept looking at him over the days, or, you know, the times I visited there, but I never said anything to him until one day he came to me and asked me, do I remember him?
Number one Lucas specialist.
Lucas?
Yeah, he plays Lucas in Brawl.
I didn't know he was.
Wasn't the strongest player. But nobody knew what he knew.
At the time, now?
At the time.
Okay.
So he was strong, mm-hmm. but he wasn't the strongest. But it didn't matter. When I say nobody knew Lucas the way he did, mm-hmm. he knew that character in and out.
Yes, so, and I can see why. Because it was the recommendation he gave to me. So I'll tell you that even though I was playing games with this other guy, I still had the determination, you know, to not really get deep into it. I was just playing to socialize with him. I didn't want to be a part of the FGC either because, you know, in arcade days, in the 90s, I was all a part of that. I didn't want to be a part of, you know, any, you know, of the old school ways.
Yeah.
So, Nito, though, came to me and asked, do I remember him? And I said, you look familiar, but no. And he said, back in the mid 2000s, I met him at a business conference in another state before our mentors, you know, came together, and then he was like tagging along and I was tagging along, mm-hmm. and we met each other. So I think it was like in Philly. Maybe I met him in Philly. So I was like, oh, and then we, and that's how we became, you know, cool through that common ground. And then over time, over the weeks that I was going, yeah. I think I was going to GameStop for like 2 months until they took out the setup. They took,
yeah,
it out, took it out.
Everybody scrammed after that.
Yeah. So, I was telling him, I was thinking about getting the game, you know, once I knew that, you know, the setup was about to be taken out and I have to make a choice. Basically, the setup's gone. I won't be able to go over there and play. I have to make a choice. Do I want to continue mm-hmm. with this or not? So I was debating that. And during that time, I asked him, you know, if I were to play this game, who do you think I should, you know, use to start playing the game? I told him I want to start with Viper. He said, no. Viper's learning curve is steep. And
who is this again? This was Nito?
Yeah.
He said, oh, wow. Okay.
He said, no, her learning curve is steep. Learning curve is steep and it will hinder you from learning the game. And I interrupted him. I said, hey, you know, you don't know me too well. I like that. I appreciate, you know, that
your
challenge.
Advice.
Yeah.
Check it out.
I like the challenge. I want, you know, well, I take people's advice, but the thing is, I don't run away from challenge. So
yeah.
He actually made her more attractive by saying that she was difficult. But then he swayed me with his next statement. He said, who I think you should learn is Ryu, because he will teach you not just the character like you would be learning with Viper for 6 months, just learning the basics. Mm. You would be learning the game. And I asked, what do you mean, the game? He said, you know, like Ryu teaches something called frame data and hitboxes. And because he's so easy to use,
Nito.
So fundamental,
Nito.
You will understand the behind the scenes game mechanics. Mm. And it's because of him that I was the foremost, you know, technician beyond other so-called technicians like Air Ryu or somebody like that.
Yeah.
In the scene for a long time. And that led me to being Smug's teacher for frame data, hitboxes.
Shout out to Smug.
And everything.
Shout out to Air.
You know, mm-hmm. yeah. Option selects and all that stuff that people didn't want to put in because they thought it was cheating. Oh. I was doing that years before. For example, do you know in Street Fighter?
Air it out.
Do you know in Street Fighter 4 there was something called I forgot the technical name for it, but you know when you press focus and throw at the same time?
Yeah.
And it's like a option select,
yeah.
throw, focus, whatever, if you wanted to crumple
you
or
back that,
or dash, yeah. That I was doing that for a year.
Fudo tried to claim it as like his tech. I think it was like Fudo's tech.
No, it wasn't. The commentator said that, but they were wrong. The Japanese had it in 2011, and actually I came up with it by myself without knowing that I did. Mm. When I first learned about option selects, after what's his name, Brian Crawley beat me in a
shout
tournament.
Shout out to Brian Crawley.
Yeah, he beat me in a tournament with Balrog.
Dang.
Using just OS Suite, and I knew what he was doing in my head, but I didn't know how to stop it because I was still new.
Yeah,
I was only like 6 months old, 7 months old. 6 months old at the time, playing. So I knew of it, and I knew what it does, and I knew what was happening, but I didn't know how to stop it. And so, after I lost that tournament, I vowed to learn how to do all option selects. So that was like June 2011. During that time. Going through some tutorials, I learned the basics of how they work. Then I said, okay, so if they're telling me it works like this, and that means if I press these two buttons throw, and I press these two buttons focus, focus will override throw, and at the same time, if I press it all at the same time,
yeah,
then it will override throw because it's stronger. And I did it. And just for the sake of understanding how the mechanics work, but I didn't know I discovered something that was powerful. I didn't know that until 6 months later when Dr. Claw told me, hey, I learned this new tech.
The Japanese players
are doing it. Yeah, the Vega player. That was one of my teachers. He said, yeah, Japanese players are doing this amazing tech. Let me show you how it works. And he showed me some replays, and he was laughing at it because these guys don't know what I'm doing to them. And it was funny. And then I started doing it, and we kept for a whole year, we kept showing each other replays of us doing this, and no one knew what was happening. all the top players online. No one knew what was happening to them. And for a year, we just laughed. And until eventually, a year later, Event Hubs put an article of maybe Desk or somebody showing it off how to do it. So I was, you know, doing that for a year, double option selects and everything. Just, I was ahead by at least a year or 2 years with all those advanced things. So
now it's interesting you said, thank you so much for that, by the way. But it's interesting you say you play with Ryu and you play, you know, with all these other characters. Do you, to this day, do you focus on Ryu? Like, do you feel like Ryu teaches you the game still? Do you feel like you would you consider yourself a Ryu specialist?
No, because of what Ito said and because of that focus from that day, my focus was being a game specialist. Okay. So when you hear people nowadays talk about my main character is the game or something, like I was the first one who was truly operating with that logic. Everyone else at the time, for years after I started, they were strictly, especially in the Western Hemisphere, strictly character specialists. It was only until Ultra Street Fighter 4 came out, when all these new characters like Poison and, you know, came into the scene, and the Japanese players started using those new characters to figure them out, that the Western world started to follow their god, the god Japanese, you know, players. I don't worship those guys, but a lot of the scene does, and so they would.
You think a lot of the scene worships people?
What do you mean think? Have you not seen them like literally going like praying and stuff? Have you not seen the pictures? Have you not seen, you know, like you know, this whole like the vocabulary, just the vocabulary, yeah. You know, godlike, and you know, yeah. He's a god and Japanese gods and
firefighting game gods, yeah.
Yeah, all of that's just, in my opinion, limiting. It makes it so that you limit your prospects, because if you don't believe you're going to become so-called godlike, then you will by default achieve less. You limit yourself by even considering that someone else is, you know, that far ahead of you, and who just does things magically because they're so talented. The reason why I have Daigo in my picture and on my YouTube channel is not because I worship Daigo, it's because I had the goal of defeating Daigo and becoming the strongest Ryu, which I have done.
Wait, hold on. You have become the strongest Ryu?
Yes.
And you have become the strongest Ryu.
In Street Fighter 4, and even in Street Fighter 5 Season 1 when I was playing, you know, like, with everyone else, I was the first Ryu to find the greatest max damage combo. I was the Ryu to find his first overhead combo that ever existed in Street Fighter 5 up to that point.
You mean the counter hit? Like the overhead counter hit?
So I did media attacks give you extra frames.
Yeah.
And counter hits get you extra frames.
Yeah.
His stand light kick is 4 frames, which is the only thing that can reach after the pushback on the overhead. And it's also, you know, fast enough. But overhead on regular hit was 0 on block. So I needed 4 frames. So I got 2 frames from the counter hit and 2 frames from the meaty. 4 frames. Yeah. I mean, it's not difficult, but people are so busy, like I said, worshiping the gods that they're not finding their own technology. He says, I don't do that. I found all these things. There's so much more, you know, that I came across. But yeah, specifically in Street Fighter 4, yes, I was a superior Ryu. Now, that doesn't mean that Daigo was not the foremost Ryu's, you know, user, tournament player using Ryu to win. He was. But as the car, as the vehicle, as the actual entity.
You told me an analogy. Tell us about that analogy.
I believe I was the actual character specialist, and he was a player specializing in using Ryu.
Okay.
That's the difference.
What was the analogy again? It was like you said you were like he was the driver?
Yeah, he's the driver of Ryu, and I'm the car.
Okay.
I'm the actual, you know, Ryu car, and he's the driver. So he has borrowed over 30 of my various texts and findings, and even the way I flow through scenario to scenario, I have proof of that. And he even admits it in his book that he goes online and looks for, you know, stuff. It's not just me that he's copied. He's copied Joe Bin, WA Solid, all these guys. Whatever he finds that's, you know, is beneficial, he's gonna apply it, and that's, you know, that's commendable. So that's fine. That's what you gotta do. The only thing that I look for is for him to to, I guess, innovate his own tech. It seems like what he does is he just coasts for a while on his own fundamentals, his own, you know, decades of experience, and maybe find something that someone else, you know, has done and adds it to it.
Yeah.
But he doesn't really innovate his own thing. And so that's where I think one of the main ways he's weak in the competitive sense. He's weak in that way. But in the early 90s, you know, you only asked about Street Fighter 1, but what you don't know is that at the time, it took me 3 years as a arcade rat. You know, I would skip school and everything. I was just going to arcade all the time. One time in shop class, I took a quarter and I drilled a hole through it so I can tie a string and use it in an arcade and pull.
Damn, the unlimited coin tech.
Yeah.
Nice.
And I even learned how to use nickels and drop the nickel with just the right amount of weight.
Weight for them so to that be I, like, that's so, a quarter.
Yep, and I would use that too.
That is technological innovation.
That is innovation, right?
Yeah, that's actually it.
I don't think Daigo thought of it. I don't think he did.
No, but this is even before Daigo and Alex Way and Justin Wong, they started. I was already a top player around in this area.
Let's go.
I was a top player. I reached the top 1% in my third year. This is one of my greatest greatest achievements in competitive sports, if you want to, you know, call it sports. And actually, some players who exist in the scene today actually were there all the way back in 94 when I did this. I was teaching myself to go through the gauntlet of tough players. Back then, no one helped you, right? It was, you know, it was just kill or be killed attitude. People would steal your money and everything. It was hardcore. But I made it to the point where I was able to thrive and train with the Chinese players from Chinatown. And they were seen as the pinnacle of players, but in fact, who was really stronger? African American, you know, teenagers there. Though they were stronger than the Chinese community there, partly because, you know, they were just more they were more like a slaughterer. You know, they were more, you know, bullyish. You know,
yeah.
Just more, much more aggressive, and win lose versus the Asian community, which was win win, where they would help each other grow. You know, if they had a weak player, they would bring them in and teach them. So I think that difference in mentality put them above the Chinese guys. But once I went from just once I went from a novice to the Chinese guys, and I was welcomed as a peer, they let me train with them. I was actually like, from their, you know, in their mind, I was like kind. Once I got to that point, I needed to go to the next level, but my rival was there all the time. My rival was gatekeeping me the whole time.
Who's your rival?
At the time, his name was Miz, and there was a player named Omar. And Omar, in 94, saw me always going against Miz. And he saw this night. He was there that night, my greatest night of competitive play up to that point. And Omar ended up being Smug's Dudley student in Street Fighter 4.
Shout out to Smug, by the way.
Yeah.
I want to say that. Shout out to Smug.
Yeah, he said that. but yeah, it might be cut out. So, but yeah, He was there all the way from 94, and I met him again in, you know, 2011, 2012. Yeah, from 2010, 2011, I was with Omar, and he would talk about Miz. He said, you know, Miz has twins and everything now, but yeah, he was my rival. Every time a new fighting game came out, or whatever fighting game existed, inadvertently, he and I would pick the same main character. And so everyone always liked to see he and I fight. This one night, though, the arcade owner said, okay guys, last game, time to close, 11:30 p.m. Only the top 1% players were there, and it was Orchid versus Orchid and Street and Killer Instinct 1 on the bridge stage. And you know those stages are long,
yeah.
Right? Really long. So I learned something from a game tester there. There was a game tester who I saw on TV. I was like, what? I know that guy. So I went to the arcade and said, I know what you do now. I know why you're so strong. I know why you get win streaks, like, and you quit whenever you want to. It's because you know what no one knows. You're a game tester. I know this. And when he said, okay, you got me, then he started teaching me secret stuff that no one knew, such as Negative Edge in Killer Instinct 1, or air combos. Did you know you can air combo in Killer Instinct 1?
No.
he taught me you can do a three hit air combo. You can
I
do,
didn't.
Yeah.
Oh, that's crazy.
You can do like two normal hits and then the charge attack. So you can do saber tools.
Got you.
You can do three hit combos, but you can do like two air hits and then when you land, you can do a fireball juggle.
It's like it's kind of like Ryu's super turbo jump medium.
Yeah.
Jump medium.
And then super. Tatsu or something like that.
Yeah.
So he taught me those two specific things for Killing Streak 1, and he taught me how to do Guile's handcuffs in Street Fighter 2, his statue.
Oh, the glitch.
But guess what?
Like the lock, the glitch.
Yep. Mm-hmm. But guess what though? No one in this scene today believes it, but he taught me how to do Guile's gun. He taught me how to use Guile's gun. If I remember correctly, because I wrote it down.
Wait. What? Guile's what?
Gun. Guile has a gun, and he taught me how to do it. There was no reason for him to lie. He showed me everything he showed me. We did it right there. We put money in only to do
this. Guile's gun.
And then he showed me Guile's gun too, but the inputs were so, you know, difficult at the time to do. If I remember correctly, you had to do some directional motion.
You're going to have to go back a bit. So there's Sonic Boom.
Yes.
There's Flash Kick. And then there's Sonic
Gun.
Like
gun. Sonic, yeah. Technon.
I
heard that right?
You know Guile's back fist?
Yeah.
That's his gun. When he does it, just like a Hollywood movie, slow motion back, just like, yeah, that's his gun.
Okay.
No, but he would do a gun. But that's just the body language he would use when pulling out the gun. The back fist. So hold on now. I'm trying to put these together. So he showed me all these things. They all were real. They all worked. And then, but he couldn't do the gun because the inputs were difficult. I think it was like a flash kick, but you had to press triple punches. And then as you go up, you got to go slide your fingers down to kicks, triple kicks. It was either that or today's current Guile Street Fighter 4 Ultra 2, which is back forward, and triple punches. It was one of those two.
Okay.
So he couldn't do it, and he gave up putting money into the machine. But one day, I didn't have money. I was at the YMCA. I didn't have money, so I was just staring at the machines and daydreaming about technology. Mm-hmm. You know, just daydreaming about, you know, theorizing stuff in my head. And I was just looking at Guile fight Blanca. And then all of a sudden, even though Blanca had like, I don't know, 90% life, all of a sudden his life shot down in an instant. And I was like, what? And then this is the computer playing the killer. And then I look and, you know, Guile did a back fist, and then he shot these little yellow bullets, you know, like Pac-Man beats. He shot little yellow circles
at Blanca. Lemons.
He shot like maybe four of them. Two of them hit Blanca. The first one took off like 80% damage and
what?
Or something like that. And the next one took off the rest.
Random damage.
What?
It's got to be random damage.
80%?
Yeah, just like that. And then the screen froze because you know how the leaderboards will come up?
Yeah.
The screen froze. The leaderboards came up. And then that's how I got like a better look at everything, because the bullets were actually frozen. The remaining bullets, because he like shot like a brrr, like that.
Yeah.
So the remaining bullets were on the screen. So I was like, yo.
It's very American.
Like up to that point, no one believed me. They said I was gullible and stuff like that. I was like, yo, I have proof right here. So then I looked around and everyone was gone because they went upstairs at 12:30 to play basketball. And the only person who was there was on the second floor. I was in the basement. I could see her over the ramp, over the wall. She was a secretary. I was like, oh man, she's not gonna care. She's not even, she won't even be down here in time if I ask her to rush down here and see this. So yeah. I was like, ah, this sucks. But I saw it for myself. Guile has a gun. I know what it looks like. I know all about that. So, but getting back to that night though, this particular guy who showed all this stuff to me, helped me to beat my rival, because on that last game, when everyone was circled around watching the two rivals play, my rival Miz went into his standard pattern, which was around 20 seconds left on the clock. He started to run. And so he would run, throw a fireball, jump back, and he would use the stage length to
make it hard for me. He's
trying to cheese out. Whatever. I don't really use these terms, but that's a relatable term for you guys. Mm-hmm. So he was trying to use that strategy, and I knew he was, because this is what he does all of the time. But I was happy this time that he was doing it, because I have something that no one has ever seen before up to that point. And that was negative edge leopard leap with Orchid to go through the fireball and hit him with Ultra. And I don't know if you know this, but negative edge special moves in Counter Strike 1, they go double the distance. Double the distance, yes.
Damn.
So I knew, because no one knew that.
I'm holding everything down.
And he would think that he was so-called safe, that I would win by default. I knew I was going to win even before the match started because of this specific thing, and I knew his end-game strategy. So, yeah, when he did it, I pretended like, well, first I have to charge, right? So I did not want him to think that something was up. So I intentionally jumped on top of some fireballs to make it look like I was struggling, and so he can buy into his strategy. I blocked some fireballs. I neutral jumped some fireballs. And then one time, I jumped over a fireball, and when I landed, I whiffed Crouching Fierce Punch to make it look like I've made a mistake doing the real fireball.
Oh, shit.
To counter him. So he would not know that this was a negative
edge. You're hiding.
Yeah, I was hiding. And then, basically, I just fainted, or feigned helplessness. Mm. Just until the clock went down to 3 seconds, and I just was looking at the clock. And when it started flashing, then I waited for that next fireball. I went through it. I went 2 times the distance. No one expected it. And I hit an ultra. Everyone was blowing up. It was awesome.
That was awesome. That's awesome.
And because of that.
That's so sick.
Because of that win, I got welcomed, ushered into the top 1%. And then they started driving me home. They started teaching me stuff. Yeah,
treating you differently.
Yep, they treated me differently. Up to that point, I was like the younger kid because they were like 15, 16, and I was like 13, 14. Yeah, so they welcomed me in, and that's how I became the top 1% player.
Moving from there, from the player aspect to you, really quickly.
I'm sorry.
No, not at all.
I went all over the place.
What? Not at all. No, we're gonna keep doing that. That's just how it's gonna be.
Yeah.
That's okay. Mm-hmm. If someone was to be a student of yours, mm-hmm. what do you look for in a student?
A flexible mind, number one. Okay. So if a person is
someone wants to come to you, be like, you know what, Kaizen, teach me. I want to be. What do you look for?
My best student. I've had many so-called best students that were the best student in different ways. Mm-hmm. But I guess, let me say, not the best student, but the easiest to work with was Kaiser Rose. He was my student. Excuse me. The easiest student for
I'm
me
trying to kill work, you in this episode.
The easiest Not student sh- for me to work with was yeah. Kaiser Rose.
Okay.
I was the teacher for many of the top, like number one and top 10 Xbox Live players. You know, as Smug, Smug was number one Dudley. I think one day I counted how many students are in the top, you know, like the number one spot for each character of the game. And I think at the time there was maybe like 35 plus, 30 to 44, something like that. 35 to 44. And I think about 22 of them were my students. 22. Of the number one spots for each character were my students, including the number one Cammy. So that guy, his name was Poipo Toipo, mm-hmm. and Poipo being my student, who had his own student who was a Cammy player named Kaiser Rose, who was a number five Cammy at the time, recommended me to him. So then I guess Poipo invited me to to a lobby. I got to, I played him first, I beat him, perfected him and everything. I think he was, in my opinion, he was going easy just to show me off to a student. And then I played against Kaiser Rose, and yeah, he needed a lot of work. So then right after that, Poipo said, okay, I'll leave you guys alone. And then I brought Kaiser Rose in to my party so I can talk to him in my replay channel. I try to set the tone for him. I try to screen him to see how he thinks and his maturity level and all that stuff, mm-hmm. all the little qualifiers I do. And as I was doing my typical process of screening a player to work with me, because I only work with people who number one, have a definite dream to achieve, and number two, work in a win-win capacity. I try not to work with win-lose people. Sometimes I do, because I hope that if I can show them what a win-win looks like, because a lot of people don't know what win-win looks like, then they will convert over to win-win mentality. But for the most part, I go through a typical screening process. And as I was doing this, he kept stopping me, saying, you don't have to do that with me. You don't have to beat around the bush or whatever you're doing. Just tell me what to do. And I guess because his teacher vouched for me, I didn't need to do all that. But because many people said that before, I kept doing it. And then it got to the point where he told me, he had to tell me like three to five times. And then he said, look, let me tell you this. He said, I got a full scholarship to college to play tennis. And my coach was Serena Williams' coach. So I understand all this, you know, the mentality and whatever you're mm-hmm. trying to tell me. Just tell me what to do. So I gave him an hour and a half lesson. And boom, he was done. Everything changed. His mindset was already changed. He said, oh, I'm a fraud. This is not my opinion. It's not my opinion. This is what his conclusion.
An hour and a half to be like, all right, I'm a fraud.
He said, I'm a fraud. He said, Cammy got me this A+, not me. I have to restructure everything. So he was upset with Cammy, and he got rid of Cammy. He switched to Viper and Evil Ryu. He brought these characters up from like zero to like A rank, both of them in like 1 month. After the first week or two, I went back to him just to see how he was doing, like with the homework, because I give homework. And yeah, he made two videos that you can see on YouTube showing option stocks, showing some of the advanced stuff that I, you know, helped him understand. Because remember, he's 8+, so he understands a lot of things. So I could already skip to option selects. Mm. You know, I ask people what they want me to help them learn.
Right.
So I showed him that. He made videos as part of the homework, you know, the passing homework, I guess you could say. And yeah, they were great. He fully understood what I showed him. So I was like, okay. So after that, I was pretty much done. So only an hour and a half, and this guy changed everything, and he was able to get to A rank without gimmicks or without, you know, advantages that Cammy gives over, you know, newer players or something like that. And then I think 2 months later, he said that he was comfortable now with it, you know, understanding the game from a new perspective and playing fundamentally, that he trusts himself to go back to Cammy. So he went back to Cammy, and then he played, everything was just fine. We were training partners and just kept in touch until Ultra Street Fighter 4 came out. When that came out, he was the first, in the first month, he became the first A-rank Poison over Broly Legs. Broly Legs was trying to race, assuming that by default he was going to be the first A-rank Poison. He just assumed that, but out of the blue, this unknown guy, Kaiser Rose, beat him. Kaiser Rose didn't have a job at the time. He was just playing all day. So then they got into a beef because Broly Legs, you know, didn't like, you know, what
Shouts
happened.
To Broly Legs.
Yeah, yeah. Broly Legs didn't like what happened. He was, you know, telling his stream that this guy's, you know, fake and he's cheating and stuff. And so Kaiser Rose just went over there and beat him. He also beat, I think, Pyo Balrog in a mirror match. Balrog versus Balrog.
Wow.
Yeah.
Shouts to Eduardo.
He was just showing that he's real. You know, he went to these streams to show that he's real. And then he became the first A+ Poison. But at A+, I knew that, you know, like the range that he has to improve is small, but the significance will be great. Also, the range of competitors is going to be small, so he's going to have less variation, variety to analyze, and it'll be harder for him to see his flaws. So that's when I stepped in, and after doing some analysis on my own of his play, because I just wanted to check on my student using a fireball character for the first time. Mm-hmm. I'm really strong in fireball pressure. So when I saw that he does not or did not know how to use fireballs properly, I accosted him and offered another lesson,
Is that, you feel like, is your specialty? Sorry to cut you off. You feel like fireball pressure is the thing you teach the best out of any other mentor you feel?
No, I think just fundamentals is, if you want to say that.
Fundamentals?
Fundamentals, but in that subject or that area, you know, that field of fundamentals, I guess I would say that, yes, I guess fireballs would be something that I do in an unparalleled way, I guess you could say. I teach in an unparalleled way. So because of that, I saw he was weak in fireball pressure. Actually, that's partly why Zafirino is now the number one Sagat in the world. As he claims, as many others claim. I mean, I don't play, so I can't say that. I can't tell if it's true. But him telling me that Mago or whoever is using Sagat in the Japanese, you know, scene is copying him now, and you know, him winning tournaments with Sagat, I guess that's true. I have to
Zaf's godlike. I like playing Zaf, mm-hmm. and I like watching Zaf. I like both.
So yeah, Zaf, you know, as my student, he started off as Feilong, but it took me a long time to try to get him to use a fireball character, and when he finally did, yeah, I had to teach him. I've been teaching him how to use fireball characters since Street Fighter 4. So and he went through Guile and, you know, everything. So, but getting back to Kaiser Rose, I gave him another 1.5 hour lesson. And after that, he went from A plus to Master Rank. And he attributed that to my fireball pressure in lecture on that subject. So that student, I invested the least amount of time, seeing the greatest fruit. And what I mean by fruit is not something for me, but seeing that he grew the most. Mm-hmm. And did not receive any backlash, such as plagiarism. Or hate by, you know, back talk and trash talk behind my back. It was just straight up, just a pure win-win deal with minimal effort and massive results.
Let me ask it. So you've obviously been able to see like weak points in other mentors mm-hmm. as well, not just students, but other mentors. What do you feel like a lot of mentors like fail to teach other students? Like, what do you feel like other mentors could do better to help them, but you're noticing, man, they're really not teaching them, or they're really not pushing them as far as they could go?
When you say mentors, do you mean mentors or teachers again? Because
teachers, rather. Okay.
Because there's not many so-called mentors in the scene. There's more, if there's anything, there's going to be teachers.
What would you
I would say like Alex Valle tends to be a mentor. Alex Valle tends to be a mentor and teacher kind of guy, but...
So what, in your opinion, what's the difference between mentor and teacher?
I'll tell you what I learned when I was in business and in sales. They said, you know, one of my mentors at that time said, he said it in regards to friend versus mentor, not teacher versus mentor.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll still say it. He said, a friend is somebody who loves you so much, they don't want you to change. And a mentor is somebody who loves you so much they want you to change. They don't want to see you the same. They want you to improve. So I would say that is similar to, you know, answering your question, because in the scene we have teachers who just say, okay, let me see some of your replays. Oh, you jump too much. Stop jumping, you know, this and that. You know, they just tell you like
points. So you feel like mentors have more invested in the person.
Well, they want the person to improve beyond just the game.
Okay.
You know, but when you see Gutex charging $120 an hour for Street Fighter lessons and only saying, "Oh, stop jumping too much, gotta be more patient," like that's not good value, and I think that hurts the community a lot. Not because of the you know, the idea of charging people for lessons,
mm-hmm.
but because the value is there for the amount of money they're charging. Justin Wong charging $60 an hour, K Bright $80 an hour. All of that was too much. Furthermore, you know, compared to the value they offered, anyone could just, you know, analyze their own replays. Nowadays, people accept that they have to do that because my student Rob TV helped people see that through his video talking about analyze replays, because that's what I did with him. You know, at the time when I was working with Rob TV, Zarpinos, all these people, they didn't. That was another thing people frowned upon, was looking at replays. They would say, Kaizen, why would I waste time in the replay channel when I could just go and play strong players and I'll learn? You know, so this is what David Serling called in his book, Playing to Win. He called these types of people.
Yeah, I read that book.
Yeah, he calls these people slaughterers. Slaughterers. Slaughterers, they are like Akuma type people. They go out and they just want to fight, and they get better by fighting stronger players. You know, another way you could think about it is Vegeta. Vegeta versus Goku. I'm a Goku kind of guy. I sandbag, like Goku sandbags, you know, and everything. You know, when I'm losing, I come up with creative solutions mm-hmm. to come back. Vegeta is just, you know, straight hardcore. Like, you're wasting time. Why are you wasting time? Finish them all quickly. You know, why would I be in a replay channel? That's wasting time. Let me just go fight someone strong. Mm-hmm. That's the general idea that came up with the OGs. Until Street Fighter V came along, and then we had all the esports and, you know, apps and all these things teaching people, you know, technology, and then finally, you know, my students, you know, sharing my lessons, such as my turns lesson, and you know the whole taking turns thing. That's my lesson, and the whole thing about, you know, watching replays and don't be afraid of your losses and all that. It's sad that I had to tell people that, but you know, the scene, that's just not how they were, and but now they are. So I'm glad to see people embrace that, you know, nowadays. So yeah, I would say a teacher, specifically in this scene, would be somebody who just says, oh, do this, don't do that. But a mentor would be somebody who says the same thing, but then afterwards, as they have lunch or something, you know, helps that person mature as a human being. So some of my students have changed their majors and colleges, I mentioned before. I have other people who left Street Fighter altogether and became successful in business. So, and these are not direct, these are not directions that gave given to them.
No, these are just,
these are things they realize themselves. Own. Yeah, on their own. So, Nell, in your interview, Nell, you know, he said that I helped him regain his courage, you know, or confidence, his confidence. I didn't tell him that, you know, I just shared some things with him and I showed him how confident I was. And I'm confident because of my skill set, and that rubbed off, you know. So.
Okay. Damn. That's a lot. That's a mouthful. Okay. Perfect.
I don't know if it makes sense.
No, it does. Where do you feel? What's the future for Kaizen Master in terms of the FGC? Do you feel like you still want to be, you love the FGC still? You still like, you have a future in the FGC, or do you feel like you want to branch out to something else?
That's another good question. It's a tricky answer. Number one, I don't consider myself a gamer, and I don't consider myself a person who loves the FGC. I'm just kind of like a wanderer going through different, you know, phases of life, and wherever I am, I help people, and I do my best. So that's that. Like, I just happen to be in FGC, and I do like games because they have a competitive aspect of them.
Yeah,
I could apply myself in that way, but I don't consider myself in anything, actually, not just about gaming, but I don't really consider myself like a fan or a part of a tribe or anything like that. I just consider myself a human being who's here, and if there's a challenge in the way, I'll try to overcome it. And I learned a lot of things. You know, I'm kind of like, you know, Joe Rogan, how he has like different, you know, different, you know, interests, like that are like left and right, up and down.
He has a podcast, he has comedy.
Yeah. That's how I am. And actually, I met Joe Rogan many times in my life. And in fact, I believe he was my Taekwondo teacher when he lived
in Boston. Back in the day,
yeah, I believe
in Boston,
yeah, in the 80s, like late 80s,
near BU.
See, he talks about that BU part, but I think he only taught where in my YMCA in Roxbury. I think he taught there.
Gonna forward this to Joe, okay?
I think he taught that. I wanted to say this to him, but I think he taught only for 1 month there, and then because my mother said, hey, there's a brand new class, you know, Taekwondo class at the YMCA. So I got in it, and then because this one kid kept popping his head into the gym and kept disturbing, you know, my teacher, and to the point where my teacher just kept having to chase him, and then the guy would run away, and then the teacher would come back and stop the class, and this went on for like 5 or 6 times. Mm-hmm. You know Joe, he doesn't like people messing around. He just quits things.
Yeah,
if he doesn't like it, he'll just quit. So I think he only did that for like a week or to a month. Not a week, maybe 2 weeks to a month, and then I think that's one reason why he might not remember it, But this guy, I believe his name is Joe. Everything was like Joe. And then when I met Joe again in the late 90s, because I worked at the Comedy Connection in downtown Faneuil Hall. I met him. He was a comedian there. I met Bill Burr. I met all these guys, Dave Chappelle, all these guys. I spoke with him there, and he looked the same. We were the same height, you know, and everything. Yeah, I was actually about this height when I was 13. I was about 5'9 or something. So, yeah. So I kind of think like Joe Rogan. I just, wherever I am, I just try to add value. I try to find women.
Pumper Jam, for example. Pumper Jam is
Pumper Jam is actually one of my other great students. He was a student of Zaffarino, who was my student. Zafrin will say, hey, you know, this guy's...
Take it, you're the grand mentor, right? I got my timeline right, there's a mentor, there's a grand mentor.
Zafrino did a great job, you know, teaching, you know, helping me to reach out to the scene. I do care about this scene growing.
Okay.
Which is why,
you know... That was my next question, yeah.
Which is why I strongly encourage Zafrino to learn leadership principles and and practice, the attitude and mindset of being a leader. And then he would go, sometimes he would, there was a time when he was trying to, you know, learn how to do this, assert himself in a leadership capacity. And he would go out to the community, maybe in GU or something, or on the forums, and people would mock him a little bit, or he had some, you know, pushback here and there. But eventually, you know, through his wins, I guess, they accepted him. But he started to spread, you know, spread my teachings. He started to help people, try to get people to work together instead of all this hatred that New England, you know, kind of grew off of in the, you know, late, you know, like pre Street Fighter 4 times.
Yeah.
You know, there was a team called Team Hate, I guess.
Yeah.
You know about that? I don't know.
Shout
about
out
that.
To Tom Vigil. That he's got a three-parter coming out that I'm sure he's excited for. He actually reached out to me.
Yeah, Tom, I worked with Tom since 2010, so yeah, Tom's cool too.
Shout out to Tom. Team Hate.
He still so, reps it.
Team Hate.
But my mission was to get rid of the dynasty of the Stevens brothers, because they were also perpetuating that, and they were holding the whole scene back by just hoarding the top, you know, their elite information, their elite skill set, and then just knocking people out, gatekeeping everyone from getting, you know, out of New England. They were just, you know, holding people back, in my opinion. So by helping Zafrino in 4 months go from wanting to quit the game to beating every player one by one, Lucky Lee, Alex Smith, you know, Brian Crowley, you know, Neutron, and etc., all the way until the Stevens brothers in 4 months, that journey was pivotal, and that was one of my most important things I did for the scene, is helping take down their dynasty. Once Zafrino beat those two guys, They retired. That's why they're not around. They retired, and then that brought in a new era, and that new era was going to be win-win, not win-lose. And so Zafrino helped to push it along by, you know, being, you know, asserting himself as a leader and teaching people such as Pumper Jam. Mm-hmm. And then when I finally met Pumper Jam, you know, years later, when Street Fighter V came out, I taught him as my Rashid student. I had many Rashid students before him, some internationally, so I kind of understood the character. Then I helped Pumper Jam, and then 2 months after working with him, he won his first tournament in locally here. So, and he's just growing on his own. He understands the thought process that goes along with training, and I love what he's doing in Dragon Ball and everything. He's still encouraging people. He's still trying to create his own win-win deals with people, and that's all I'm looking for is just growth and cooperation from people, and then I want to see those I work with do the same and just have that just, you know, trickle down throughout the scene.
That's pretty fitting with the definition I found for the word Kaizen while I was sitting here.
I forgot to bring that up.
Yeah, so you can talk about what Kaizen means to you.
Talk about that right now, actually. Thank you.
So people get that wrong. People get my name wrong. Especially my haters. I have a lot of haters, by the way. I think I have more haters than supporters.
What does Kaizen Master mean to you?
I'm going
to
tell you. I'm not going to go off track. Kaizen means, for one thing, the definition he probably saw is constantly improve.
Yeah.
But how come, what's the master about? Well, this is where people get it wrong. People think that I think that I'm a master level. They don't really know what Kaizen means. They just think that he's calling himself a master.
Yeah.
So they laugh. But in fact, when I was coming up with a name with this guy called Amar, who was also Zafrino's mentor.
Oh, man, Gamer Ducks.
Game Ducks. Yeah, I was vice president of Game Ducks and number one investor, financial investor.
I was in it. So that's why I know.
Yeah, so that's where I knew you.
I was like, I was
so
in
that's where, yeah, I remember you. I think I have a picture of you. I knew I recognized you, man. So come on, you held that back from me this whole time.
Hey, it was never brought up. I'm not holding anything in.
Yeah,
I'm not sneaky.
Okay, so let's see. So when I was coming up with this name with Amar in his kitchen, you know, we're coming up with names and stuff. I wanted to use the word Kaizen. Eventually, I got to the point where I thought of the word Kaizen. I knew about it through business because it's a business principle that they teach in a, you know, a high level business schools. Mm-hmm. It's a, you know, an Eastern philosophy that works well, and especially in Japan. And so they brought it over to do business, you know, or teach yeah. in business schools in the West. So Master Kaizen was an option, but I didn't like it. I said, I don't. I think he brought that up, and I said, I don't like that because I don't. I want to be a student. I don't want to ever have like any notion of like in my mind being anything like seeping in my mind of yeah. being a master.
Trying to keep yourself humble.
So then I flipped it around, and Kaizen Master came about, and then eventually over time I developed more meaning behind mm-hmm. the name. So now I say that my name stands for constantly improve towards mastery. That's what my name means to me
right.
now.
Right. So you're just always trying to be better than you are the day before.
That's what Kaizen means. That's the definition.
Perfect.
And by the way,
perfect.
I don't even know how not to do that. And I thought growing up that most people do that as well.
Normally.
I thought as a kid that, oh, adults are like, they're people who kept improving as they aged, you know, and it just, until they die. And mm-hmm. that's what I thought adults did. But then when I became an adult and I see like, you know, so many, like one time I was 17 years old in my first job, and it was a 31-year-old guy who behaved worse than teenagers, you know, my age. He was a chronic smoker, and he was angry. One time, I put him in a situation, indirectly, I put him in a situation where he got a promotion that he didn't want, because I wanted his spot. But the owners of the company said, we don't have enough to pay two of you to be in that spot. So I said, I'll do it for free. I have to learn. I told the owners, I cannot stay as a dishwasher yeah. this whole time in a restaurant. I have to improve. So either I improve or I leave. And so I said, I can do this job as a prep cook. So they said, okay. I did not know that they were going to promote him. I thought they were going to just have both of us do prep cook, right? And yeah. I was going to work for free. He's going to be paid. I didn't know that they set us up. So had to be at work at like 8:30 in the morning. They told him to be a line cook, and I was going to be the prep cook in his spot. But they didn't have the cook show up at 9 o'clock or 9 o'clock or 9:30. They told the cooks to stay home to put us both to the test, and I didn't know this. So by 9:15 or so, 9:30, I started realizing, wait a second, they're never late. All the chefs are late all at the same time. No, something's going on. So I was like, I'm being tested right now. So I rose up to the occasion. And during this time when I was in the basement and he was doing the line cook stuff, all I kept hearing is swearing, cursing, and slamming pots. And he did not want to be there. He didn't know what to do. He was out of control. And when the cooks finally showed up and I did all my job, they were working with them side by side. It was just terrible. They did not like it. So what they started to do over time, like maybe 1 or 2 weeks of working with him, they started moving me up to line cook all of a sudden. They started teaching me how to make a roux. They started teaching me how to cook. And they put me through my final test. They actually, when it was lunchtime and the restaurant was dead, the restaurant was gone, they put me through another test. The bartender came in, busted, kicked open the door. Oh my gosh, we have an important person here. He wants this and that. Where's the chef? And I looked. And I can't find them because it was a test, right? So they all hid away. And then he came in again. Yeah, man, this guy is waiting. You can't find him? Then do you know how to make this? You make that for your lunch, right? I said, yes, I do. So he's like, can you make it for me? Yeah, I made it. I met the guy. You know, I served it to him. He's like, wow, I can't believe the dishwasher, you know, made this, you know, this stuff. You know, so, and so, like, that's an example of me seeing, you know, adults, like, shattering that notion that other people do what I do naturally, which is constantly improve. I learned many times after that a lot of times people just, they grow. There's a quote that says, most people, you know, live to 25, and most people are born and they die at 25, but they don't get buried till 55. What that means is, you know, they live and they go through the routine of going to school, getting a job and everything, and then they don't have any dreams, they don't have any aspirations.
Yeah, like, where do they go from there?
Yeah, so they just get into this rut until 55, until they're dead. So they live and they challenge themselves, they experience things, and then they settle down at 25, and then but they don't get buried. So they die because they got rid of their dream. Whatever dreams they had as a young kid, they're gone because now I have to go to work.
Yeah.
So yeah, people stop growing. But I also learned that your age is not necessarily determined by your physical body. It's mostly in the mind, and you can tell how old you are based upon the last time you changed your mind. The last time you changed your mind. A person, if I told you right now, you know, something, like for example, do you know the FTSE Sand book?
Yeah.
Teaches never crouch, never block. The FTSE Sand book teaches never crouch, never block. But in this scene, that's all we hear is, oh, he has to be safe. You know, like, stay back and, you know, like, just, you know, don't take any risk and stuff. You know, just hold down back and let time run out, you know. But FTSE Sand book says never cross, never block. When I teach people something like that, they don't understand why. And I, of course, have to go through many different lessons to teach them why. But that's something where a person might have to change their mind. And if you're incapable of changing your mind, then you're old. The last time you change your mind,
I like that,
is determines how young you are.
I like that. Honestly, right, there's so much we can delve into.
Yeah, yeah.
This is definitely not the last time we're going to have you as a guest, of course. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, Kaizen Master, if you have anything to leave off with, anything to tell the people as like a mantra, as like a final saying, what would it be right now?
That's another good question. That's probably the hardest one. I would say, think for yourself.
All right, I like that. Think for yourself. If you guys need anything, you guys can follow Kaizen Master on his YouTube. It's Kaizen Master for anything Street Fighter related, anything non-Street Fighter related. It's up on his YouTube. If you need to reach out to him to be any kind of life coach, Street Fighter coach, mental coach, he's always there for you. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. This is going to be the episode of Beyond Frame Day. Thank you, brother.
Thanks.
Thanks so much.
Yep.